Hallelujah. Come on, hallelujah. 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 Oh, yes. You may be seated, Israel. Oh, yes. You may be seated. What a great blessing. Your grandson to the nation of his people. And this nation is his ummah, the tribes, the elect, the progeneration of a remnant, a zira out of the bosom of Abraham. And by that birth, we see the promises granted unto Yitzchak, Yaakov, shall there be at the house, the dwelling place of Yah's Ruach, then that remnant, that zira, shall be blessed of Yah. He shall berach. He shall bow down his ears to them. He shall bow down unto them. He shall make himself known unto them. And also he will kara, he will curse them as well. This is vitally important that we understand, Yisra'el, the mandate that Yah commands a nation of people to make known the excellence of his name, his power, and that we have no resolve without him. There is nowhere else to go. You can't go anywhere else and find the remedies. They are nowhere to be found. You may seek and search, require, inquire. You will not find the resolute. You will not find the absolute. Because until you began to deal with the integrity of any man's heart, you will never find out the essence of that man. We are a people that are energized to protect our own wickedness and our sins. So Yah's going to send one of the same nature that will strengthen you in that action and the attitude that you will recoil against him like a vicious behemoth, like a serpent is supposed to recoil. And as he speaks unto the nation to correct us, to cleanse us from all of our filthy, vile, repugnant, unclean ways, and we rejoice in that. We let it be known unto him that we are appreciative to what Yah is doing. We're among a generation that's a heathen generation. Even Yah says he used that adjective that I use, my people. Are we the people of Yah Yisra'el? He says that my people are evil. They're foolish. Do we understand the connotation of that when Yah says that we are evil? I use the expression quite often here, but he says, my people are evil. They are foolish. They are the ones that despise my wisdom, the knowledge, the da'at, the binah, the being, the wisdom, the understanding of wisdom. My people, he says. He says, my people, they are evil. They are despisers of wisdom. They reject it. And that's why you find a foolish generation of young men and women that know everything, and it's a damnable protocol in their lives. He said, my people are evil. They are foolish. They despise my counsel, my muzah, my wisdom. He says, and the reason that they are foolish is because they have not yada. They have not experienced me. What a man experienced, Almighty Yah, there is an exaltation of his excellent power. We're foolish because we have not yada. We have not experienced Almighty Yah. He is not that valuable to us. He is not important. His Hamashiach, he is not important to us at all. And then he classifies us as we are Sachal. We are Satish children. I didn't say it. He calls us his bane.
We're satish.
In essence, he says that that way to say they are nothing but a pack of damned fools. That is what Sakhal is. They're damn fools. They're damn fools. They're ignorant, damn fools. He said, but the way of Rasha, to do evil, they are skillful in that. They are cunning, they're craftsmen, they craft their own ways, the direction, their own right hand, their own yamim. They're skillful. They're skillful to do evil. They have the wisdom to do what is wicked and evil before me. And he says that the derech, or the way of Tav Sodik, he said they yada not. They have no understanding. They don't even rejoice in Yeshua walking in the right way because they don't know. We know how to do every kind of damnable evil action there is. There's a mind that is taken toward the direction of, and that is what Yomim represents. They shall receive the oath, the mark, in their right Yamim, right Yah, their right hand. And it tells us, shows us, the direction that that mind shall operate in. We must understand the details of that. It is one thing that, as I see things in the Brit Hadassah, we cannot bring clarity to that unless we go back to the covenant, to the Brit, written by the pens of the Novi, of the Navim, the prophets, and the mighty messengers of Yah as they stood before congregation of people, Yisrael, that were blatant defiance of Yah. They had no regards. They had no respect unto Yah at all. There was no yira. They did not fear him. There was no great reverence unto him at all. And if we will search the very depths of our own bosom, we'll find that there's very little of any kind of great honor unto Yah. That course out of our daily lives, our daily hours, minutes, and seconds of life. For the mind that takes us in a direction is not the mind that takes us in the direction of his path. And there's only one mind that can do that. And that's the mind of Yeshua HaMashiach. I don't give a damn what these fools say, as they are evil, they are fools. They are sakhal, they are twisted in their damnable, convoluted, perverted mind. They have created their gods and the images of their gods according to their minuscule. It's not worth even a grain of salt. Their ignorance, their unlearned ability of the ways of Yah. And that's what they have done. They have created the image of their own God. They know not the way of Yah. To do evil, we are excellent at doing evil. But to do right, to do that which is tough, to walk in the Sadiq, which represents the nuances or the little pieces and bits of the character, the characteristics of Almighty Yah. We must walk in that Yisrael. That's why he gave us a Torah, a body of stipulations that governs that mind that rises up against him in upheaval, in enmity, that rejects and fights against him, that resists him. And there is not one that has lived and one that is alive whose mind has not risen up against Almighty Yahweh. Not one mind. There is only one mind that has not risen up. That is the mind of Yeshua HaMashiach. That's why we must let
to permit, to allow, to grant, to give the will, the purpose, the occasion, that that mind that was in Yeshua HaMashiach, that we dwell and walk in that same mind. If we are not walking in that mind, we're walking in a mind that is diametrically opposed to the Most High. And we're not going to enter into the bed of Yah. We greet you all that have joined us on the live broadcast, the live audio, and the live visual. Yeshua's mighty name, I'm going to preach a little today. I may hollow, I may yell, I may stream. That's all right. I will not be apologetic. I may say damn, and I frankly do not give a damn. There was one that wrote me last week because of what I expound upon. And it is one thing that there are things in this nation that the vast media has strained the minds whereby you don't want to touch. And if you touch certain things, your looks or you're perceived, you are identified as a hater because you deal with truth. So the individual writes me and says to me, what are you? I should have brought the letter and read it to you and you, our listening audience. In essence, you sound like you are an angry man of the diaspora, quote, a black man, unquote, whereby I don't give a damn, I don't care. Also, he implies that you sound as though that you are somewhat of a defunct Muslim. This is the mindset of this wicked generation, because it covet sin. It covet sin. We as Yisrael, we cover, we don't covet. We shall not covet. That's the command of Yah. And so we cover the sins of Yisrael. If my ark falls, we do not proclaim that to the masses. If our hold comes short of the inspiration, we do not reject, we cover that. By applying the dom of Yeshua HaMashiach. So I am an angry man of the diaspora. I am one that have issues because I dealt with the issue of a blatant, vile mindset that doesn't give a damn about any people, nationality, any heritage, or any nation of people. I was reading, I didn't read the entire article, but I was looking at the Navajo Indians and the deplorable conditions that they live on the reservations. Do you understand? But this is a nation with a constitution says justice and freedom for all, that every man has the right to pursue, to engage, and to seek after those things that will bring the resolve or the remedy to one's life. We are all created equal. It is a damn vile lie of darkness. Those that inscribed, wrote from a mind that was directed toward hell are the same ones that banded that nation of people upon a reservation. And the article was implying that they are even more isolated because there is no internet. They do not have anything to connect with the external. And if they truly had leaders there, true leaders, they could raise up a monumental people. I know what can be done. This is a damn twisted generation that doesn't give a damn about anyone. But they're true leaders. And the resources of their wealth would be great. They will have a great strength of finance. And so they are led as a belligerent people into drunkenness, drugs. There is something cataclysmic that has caused that people to go that way. I'm going to preach in a moment. I will never forget a statement that Evangelist Hartsfield made to me. He looks at me one day and he said, Brother Roberts, he says one thing that the Most High, he doesn't judge by the seed or the eyes. He would do that. That would be his mannerism. He says, when Yah sees the man that is a drunkard, although he knows all things, he asks the question, why? And someone must give an answer. And I know this is a generation said, well, I did not do it. But Yah says that those that hate me, that sone, that despise me, rejects my mitzvah, he said, I will send the curse of the father upon the children down to the third and the fourth generation. You may not be a culprit of it, but your father and his father were. And you shall redeem the rewards of your father and your father's action, my friend. I don't give a damn what you think or what you say. And he went on to say, Yah looks at why is this man conditioned this deplorable? And he began to search the docket. And as he searched the docket, he would say, this is the reason why. Because of this wicked man and the heritage of his wicked children that caused this man to be relegated to this state, for he shall pay, and his lineage shall stand in the presence of my judgment. That's why Yah commands us, as much as we as a nation even said to Yisrael, when you pass through the land of Seir, the mountain, he said, you don't come against, you don't mess with, you don't even try to attack Esav. He said, leave them alone. You buy food if you need it. You don't take it. You don't go and mock them as they have mocked you. For the day of recompense shall come, and it is at hand. And the very mindsets of Esav is to bring the most debilitating, destructive mass against the mind of Yahshua HaMashiach, against the mind of Yaakov Yisrael. It is a mind that pursues the very mind of Yahshua to destroy it, to bring it down to naught, that people that are subject unto that law may follow in the path of Esav. We as a nation of people of Yisrael, we are people that despise, we do not love the knowledge of Yah. We love foolishness and lies. We don't love knowledge. We don't love His Musa, His counsel to rebuke us, to reprove us, to correct us. So the man that listened, and he listened on an iPhone, he was appalled at what I was saying. Because you don't pull the skirts off of the whiteness of this nation. I don't give a damn. I will not protect that. I will not. And I'm not fearful of any man. And he is a true man that has the Ruach HaKodesh of Yah in him. He will defy it, destroy it, and bring it down to the gates of hell. You will not defend it. You will not at all. And because undoubtedly I was encroaching upon his little reserves, his heritage, then he perceived that I'm an angry man. Well, Yah's angry every day with the wicked. I'm angry with this wicked world. I take no pleasure in it. There is no rejoicing. I rejoice in the bosom of Yahshua HaMashiach. For he is the only one that can dry my tears, Yisrael. In the comfort of the Torah, the Dabar, the Dabarim, the word of Yah. The promises is Jabbar. I rejoice in that. In all things, Yisra'iyah, we must get wisdom, we must get clarity. And there are things written in the book that we don't have clarity of. We read as though that we're reading some kind of cabalation of stories that have no interconnection or interwovenness among them. You cannot get clarity of the Brit Hadassah unless you go back to the beginning. And I somewhat fell us as I constantly fall. I fell us in my own excitement, above all in my own ignorance of not knowing, in my own ignorance of not being attentive and paying attention to the finest of detail, that I even omit some of the things that I express, that every word that Yah speaks is valuable. It is like a precious gem. It is important. And we cannot omit nor overlook what he says, because it is uttered from his faith, his mouth, his language, to open up our uzin, our revelation, or the ears, the wisdom of revelation. This is what Yah has done. And in order for us to understand the very process of this uth, or the mark of the Yamim, we must go back to the Bereshit. And on this Shabbat and next Shabbat, I want to teach from one book, and that is the book of Revelation, Giliana, chapter 13. There can be no evidence or proof of this book unless it is testified in the writings of the Nabi, of the prophets, the messengers. And it must be, and we must correlate and tie everything in together to understand the conditions, the reason why man shall be caused to receive a mark in his right hand, his yomim, and also his mesach. His mesach, that the strength of his will will be guided in a direction that is not pleasing to Yah. We see that today. We see the mind of Esav is a mind that despises Yaakov. And unless we as a nation of people allow the words, the Torah, to retch and wrestle this damnable twisted mess out of us, then we shall fall prey to that mind. That's why Yaakov said, I will not let you go until you have Berach. You must pour out the Berakiah, the blessings that were promised unto Abraham. I will not let you go. We cannot let the Torah go until there is an absolute resolve in our minds, and our ruach is refreshed, and there is a revitalization of our desire, our will, and our passion. And we got passion for every damn thing. But Yah's Torah. He was a man that was on a barren island in the Aegean Sea. He had no one to bring consolation. He had no one to speak to. No one to interact with, but as he gazed at the heavenly bodies above him, as he could see the darkness of the distance, and yet the profound light, this testimony of Yahshua was revealed unto this man. Unless we lay down our lives for the sake of Yahweh unto us, we shall be overcharged and overtaken by that mind, and we will walk in the direction of Asa, that we will sell our birthright. We will sell the rights to the heritage for the morsel of this damnable wicked bread that tastes sweet, tastes delectable, and satisfies the very opposition of that belly, satisfying the God of our belly that opposes Yah in all things. And so Yah had one man, that was willing to set aside all the luxuries of what we call life, to be willing and obedient. We're not willing to do that. I don't give a damn what we say and how we pretend. You know, there are those that, when I talk on certain things, they will write and say, oh, I love Yah. They don't even know what the love of Yah is. With generations that have been trained, our minds have been trained in a way that we cannot even detect what is pure. And so when there is a sincere messenger that stands before us, we will reject that man. We don't like what he says, because it encroaches, it comes against, it assaults what we have learned and what we believe to be right. We must understand wisdom is principle. That is the elementary thing of Yah. But in all of our getting and all of our wisdom and all of our experience with Yah, we must get understanding. We must get beamed. We must become skillful. We must become very skillful in the Torah of Yah and how to utilize the heret, the sword, or the ruach of Yah. And we are not skillful at that. We're shallow. That's why the enemy comes in upon us and overshadows and overtakes us. We are foolish people. You can esteem yourself all you want to, but it's the truth. Yah said it, I didn't say it. You got a problem, you take it to him. Is that all right? Don't bring it to me. I cannot resolve that. I have only one remedy for you. He said it. I believe it. That's enough. And it is flat out settled. There's nothing you can do to alter that, to change it. Nothing. So as far as I'm concerned, it's settled. I want to begin here in the book of Revelation, chapter 13. In order to understand this, you must understand the visitation of Yah unto the Nevi'im, the prophets, the message of the prophet. If any man speaks not according to the testimony of the testimony before their time, the Edah, if any man speaks not according to the Torah and the testimony, it is because there is no awe, no light in them. Simply implying there's no testimony of Yahshua HaMashiach in that individual. And if one speaks not accordingly that way, it's because they have no light. They have no wisdom. They have no understanding. They have no knowledge of Yah in them at all, Yisra'iyah. They can speak from the peripheral. And I find men today, they have a learning that has been set in order by men that they have regarded, but they have no experience with that knowledge. Can I show an example before I go further? It is like individuals, they will write, they will ask me one of the most stupidest questions. A question like this. You know, you're not supposed to plant different seeds in the garden. Do you all grow hybrid seeds? And of course, I'm wise with these fools. Tell me, my friend, where do you get your groceries? Oh, I go to the most expensive, you fool, organic place. Is that so? How do you know what you're getting? Are you getting hybrid? If I name an heirloom seed and a hybrid, could you tell me which one is hybrid and which one is heirloom? You ask a damnable silly question. You do that to prove your excellence, or you have a knowledge about a matter, but you have no experience about the matter. You have no experience. I will come on, man. Don't worry about that one. So you ask something that is foolish. You have no experience about the matter, but you have what you think is a head knowledge about the matter. Well, you're not supposed to grow it, and yet you're buying from the wicked. And you think you know what you're getting, Israel. Yeah. You actually think that. And yet they will ask a question that is that stupid to give them some kind of excellent, as though that I don't do that. Well, you don't even know how to farm. You know the least bit about gardening. You don't even have the tenacity to weed a garden. You don't even have the ability to combat the elements and the little bogs and all of that. You don't even possess that. So why would you ask me a damnable, foolish, silly question? And I am that bold. I don't mince my word. A man called other day, I agree with all you said. I said, I frankly don't give a damn if you don't. Oh, I know how man of Yah must be. He must be meek. I'm not fighting against Yah. Oh, we think that we don't fight against the wicked to defend the testimony of Yahshua. That's a damn lie. I don't fight against Yah. When a man is meek, he has no resistance against Yah. I lay down my life. But I will kill this bastard that offend you, Yah. I will take the sword of the Ruach and drive it to the depths of that wicked heart. We have weak men that have taught us weak lies. Now we need strong men to stand. We need the Geba, a warrior that is mighty like Uriah. See, the comfort of Bathsheba, the smell of the myrrh and the aloe will be beautiful. And the fragrance of that in my nostril and her breasts are beautiful. But I love the king greater. I love King David. I love him. And I stand to die and to kill the bastards. That's what he was fighting against. Those bastards, those manzir that rise up against my king. Yes. We don't fight these dogs that rise up against our HaMashiach. Yes. And we think, well, I answer so. No, I will not answer so. Yes. Will Karah. Yes. You will see the exploding of my vessels in my neck. Yes, yes I will. Yes. And I will not mince one word. Yes. For no one. Yes. Nobody. So as we have opportunity, we do tough unto all men, but preferably Yisrael. We do tough unto the wicked and don't give a damn about Yisrael. I watched a man one day talk about his love and how he loved and how he loves everyone, his issue and all that. And I watched him do his wife like a damn dog. And I wanted to run the blade up in his gut, but I didn't at that time. I watched him do something so appalling. I don't give a damn. I will never intrigue my issue that way. Never. That's like doing that to me. It's one thing about many men, unless one is a man, has the strength of a man, they don't want to deal with another man. You understand? Boys like playing with boys. My friend back there, he doesn't like coming and staying with me. He'd rather get his little friend and ride his bike to get him. That's what he'd rather do. And that's what boys like. They like boys. You understand? I like men and strong men, too. I like men. I like men. That's what I like. Hallelujah. I like iron because iron sharpeneth iron. Let me proceed, all right. I have a few pages here I need to preach. I'm going to preach this today. But I pray that Yah will bring a simple truth of wisdom to us that we will understand. Yochanan writes by the penmanship of Almighty Yah here in Revelation chapter 13. As he saw this Nahash, this powerful entity, this mind, the spirit that was consuming and overpowering. And he gives us details here in Revelation 13 and verse 1. Yochanan said, and I stood, I took my place upon the perch that Yah had ordained for me. He said, I stood upon the sand of the masses of the populace. I could see there was a vision of the sea, of those that were scattered abroad. I stood upon the place that Yah had ordained from the foundation of the earth for me. And he said, I saw this behemoth, or this behemoth. I saw this powerful exaltation of strength. And there were characteristics about this powerful beast that Yah began to reveal unto me, Yisrael. And I saw this behemoth. I saw this mind, this authority, this exaltation. He says, rise up out of the masses of the people, of the yam. And the yam, not only does it represent a sea or a mass of water, but the yam represents the people of the collection of nation. And I saw this powerful entity, this construct, rise up. Now either this is a book of lies, Giliana, unless the Nobi before him saw the same thing. There must be a witness, Yisrael. If I read something in the Brit Hadassah, I can't find the witness in the old book. If you notice me, I interact between both or the writing as a whole. If I don't find that, then I hold off until Yah brings the revelation of that truth to me, Yisrael. He says, this one having seven heads, seven rush, seven summits. Now we must understand, Yisrael, in order for this beast to combat or this mindset to combat Yah, it must try to perform or develop a spirit or that which will counteract. Yeah, there are only seven most powerful Rahim of Yah. And so these are kingdom or minds or the wisdom of a mind that will assault the Ruach of wisdom, that assaults the Ruach of understanding, that assaults the Ruach HaKodesh. He had seven summits. And the Rush or a summit is represented by authority, a place that sets above. And in order for him to combat the seven Ruachim of Yah, the seven spirits, then he must raise up or cause to develop a powerful mindset that is based in corrupt wisdom that is diametrically opposed to Yah. It must be Yisrael. It has to be. And he saw this one rise up out of the most vilest of spirits that flow from that mind. There is nothing like the acts of Yisrael when they came out of Misraim, that they built a damn god in every, the seven major religions of the world. We see that Catholicism. We see that in Islam. We see that in Hindu. We see that in the Indian Sikhs. There are more people in some of the provinces of India that is in the whole state of the United States. You're talking about 1 billion plus people. Not one of them going into the kingdom. One out of every four person is a Muslim. Not one is going in. Did not in Yahshua's name. Near 1 billion Catholics, all of them shall burn in the depths of hell. Now, one of them. And all of her Protestant daughters, the Baptists, the Pentecostals, the Church of God in Christ, Jehovah Witness, the Seventh-day Adventists, all of them, they're not going in. I want to stay on the focus today, all right? He saw these seven heads, these summits of power, to combat the seven Ruachim of Yah that Yeshaya talks about. The seven Ruachim that shall rest upon Yahshua HaMashiach. And so this is what the summit of the heads represent. Although it is a state or of a kingdom or a melach, a ruling governor, but it is a mind. It is the authority of the mind. It is one thing about a king. If a man, he knows that he has a leadership to the kingdomship, then he is trained to be a king. He is trained to be arrogant, to be exalted. He is trained in things that whereby the commoners are not trained in Yisrael. And so his knowledge of events and world affairs is much more precise. There must be an opposition against Yisrael. And this is the strength of our house, the pillars of Yah, the seven Ruachim of Yah. And not only that, but he had the seven heads and 10 horns. And each one of those horns represents the 10 tribes of Ephraim, of Yisrael, Yehuda, the 2 southern tribes. That is what this represents. Because Yehuda and Yisrael, they are not one. They're not one. Because one believer in their exaltation of their arrogance and their pride, that they supersede the other, and it is not so. And they must be identified, just like the mind of Esau must be identified. This one rises up, this standard, this tremendous power that nothing could abate it. And I saw rise up from the masses of the Yam, the people, the nations, the Goim of the world. You will know this because Yah is expressive, indeed telling the actions and the activities of this one that will cause men. That's why we must be wise as a serpent and harmless as a dove. He had 10 horns upon his horn, 10 crowns, and upon his head, his rush. Every one of the 7 major religions of the world, they defy the name of Yah. This most damnable, what they call pious Pope Bennett, this beast out of hell, some years ago, he said, of all of our literature, we shall extract YAHWEH. Remove that out of the Chronicles. We don't want that name to be uttered. We don't want it to be expressed. And yet those that call themselves Muslims with these rags on their heads, yet they will say that Abraham is akin to the damnable prophet, and that is a lie from hell. And yet they will not identify the name of the Most High. And this vile thing we call Christendom, she is the offspring of a dirty, vile whore. These damn Baptist whorehouses, the damnable Methodists, the damnable Church of God in Christ, the damnable Pentecostals, they will not even identify with the name of the Most High. You think that it is a small matter, but it is not. He said, upon his heads, upon not just a head, a rush, but upon the rush, that which opposes Yah is written, one word, Yisrael, and it is blasphemy. Nahatash, Nahatash, a mind that resists, that has contempt for Yah, that rejects Yah, that spawns Yah, and that literally curse Yah. They will curse at that name when you mention it. They will reject that name. He's going to cause all now. He's going to cause. He's going to implement the processes that will cause all, cold, all, young, old, poor, rich, to receive a mark, an oath, in their yamim, in their right hand. Their direction will be according to the summit whereby they are perched upon. From these summits, from every head, from every ruling government, from the 7 major powerful governments of the world, whether it is what we call democracy, communism, whether it's called democratic republic, look at the governments of what we call the 7 nations, most powerful nations, when they meet. We fought America and Germany and France and Spain, and we find Canada. Come on, these are the 7 nations of power. And tell me, do they honor the name of Yah? And tell me that their summits, what are their most vilest, that they are trying to impart on the Russian man to accept these damn faggot dogs, these damn dogs out of hell. That's what they're trying to do. It is against the Ruach of Yah. This must be made plain. We got these damn dogs like Kindler Hayward Wright, these fictitious books that are superficial. They make this out of somewhat of a fantasy that people buy into it because it's easy to believe. This, it takes the Ruach of Yah to believe this. There should be 7 heads to battle the 7 Ruachim of Yah. 7 heads. To diminish from the mind of man the Yareh, or the fear of Yah. to diminish from our minds the da'at of Yah, the knowledge of Yah, to totally eradicate by the ru'ach of Yah, the ru'ach of hukmah of wisdom, to remove that in everything today, the summits of power, whether it is their great summits like the media, internet. Don't you know on Facebook there are nearly 900 million people, billion people? And there are people that spend all day on that damn stuff. It's vile, it's wicked, the whole house, mama here, daddy here, son, that daughter, they're all on my space. What a damn wickedness. It's none of your. And this is a damn gullible generation. They don't think, look at some of the most powerful things that have been introduced to us recently. We held the cell phones. Our minds are being fried by them. Internet, we love it more than we love anything. I will mourn. This vile cauldron of hell, Hollywood, it spews out every kind of vile thing. I want to finish this. I want to get back to this. Hallelujah. So everything is of great value. And upon the head written blasphemy. Blasphemy. Words that assault Yah. That will not utilize the true name. Whatever damn false Baal. The damn corrupt name Jesus. Your damn corrupt Lord. Your damn corrupt Baals. Your damn gods are dogs. I don't take it back, Yisrael. I'm not afraid to say it that way. There are men that, because they have these superficial spirits, and because they're melancholy, they won't say it like that. They're afraid. Well, I don't want to say it and something happened. Man, you're going to die anyway. There's an appointment to death. So if y'all takes me right here today, it's not because I said damn the gods. Damn every god. Hallelujah. See, maybe he does that and you will run and began to go to the gods. Huh? What a shame. Hallelujah. I want to get into the depths of this. Here it says here in the second verse. Yah says, and this beast which I saw, he was like a mare. He was like a leopard. And his feet as the feet of a bear. And his mouth as the mouth of an eri or a lion. Yahshua is the lineage of the lion. He is the lion. He is the eri of the lion of the tribe of the Ummah of Yehuda. And so this must be an illustration that tries to personify the very essence of Yah. And I'll get into that when I began to teach on the ebbet of the stone. You know, there are things that I must lay in place before we can understand what I really want to show us in all of this, Yisrael. It's simple. Akmikaya wrote me this morning and said, Reach, that message you taught on the end of the Mo'ed of Matzvah, when I was here doing Pesach, that Shabbat. He said, when you said the word that Yah hates your feast days, when you defined the word your, he said, you didn't even have to go any farther with me. It was all clear. But yet people would still reject that. He said, and the dragon gave him power and his seat, and he gave him great authority. Why a mouth like a lion, Yisrael? Is not that mouth of Yahshua the mouth? He is a lion of the tribe of Yehuda. Doesn't exude the confidence of Yisrael? There's an army that speaks of this, not in the precise terminology as Yakahand, but he gives us this wisdom in Jeremiah. I want to show you why he has the mouth of a lion. We must understand. Jeremiah chapter 2, verse 29 and verse 30. Yah says to us, therefore, will you complain to me? You have uttered your false accusation. Why are you complaining to me? You all have poshak. You have transgressed. This one that shall rise up, he has the mouth or the feth of a lion. You'll say you have risen up. There must be a pattern of that in the covenant unto Yisrael. He has the mouth of a lion. And when we see that word, na, 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 It has the implication of one that is striped or leopard that has the almost identical indication of the lion. Listen to what Jeremiah says. Therefore, will you complain to me? Will you complain to me? This is Yah now. You have all transgressed against me, says Yah. Is that not Yah talking? Look what Yah says. He says, in shav, in vain, emptiness, I have smitten not you, but your being, your children, your taf, your children. He said they have received no muzah, no correction, no rebuke, none at all. That's why this shall be upon the house of Yaakov. This shall be the time of Yaakov's trouble, because we will not receive the correction of Yah. We're sadish, we are wicked, and we are vile. He says here, they receive no correction, none. What a blatant statement. He says, your own cherub, your own sword has devoured your Navim, your own sword has killed, devoured your own prophets. He says, like a destroying lion, he comes and he speaks as one with the mouth of a lion, whose voice will be heard throughout the bewildered place. And Yah says, Yisra'iyah, you as a nation, you have destroyed even the prophets with your mouth, your words, what you have uttered, how you speak against Yah, how you speak against his messengers. You have literally destroyed them. And Yah says, out of the midst of all of your transgression, your poshak, I shall cause one to rise up in the same similitude as you have walked in. He is going to sit upon us, Yisra'iyah, the very things we have done against him. And he shall rise up with the mouth of a lion just like you, as a lion that destroys the prophet. I shall send one with the words of his mouth. They shall be words of great destruction, Yisra'iyah. The Erisha calls by the power of his words for your Imunah, the Ruach of Imunah. These are the seven, that is one of the seven Ruachim of Yah. And calls that to be strong. We are a nation of people, we have very little Imunah, do we not? Let's get real. Why? Because hell, internet is taking it. Television is taking it. Whole world is destroying it. Family Dollars, Walmart is destroying it. Every damn thing is destroying it. The God of our wicked, unclean bellies. I can teach from this one verse here for the next 6 months concerning the mouth of the lion. I just wanted to identify that essence today, but there is much just from this. I was saying to the Ark the other day, we were sitting at the Zakim Birmin and some of the Ark Shimri. I said, you know, I have invitations all the time for meetings all over the world, but I'm not one that is impressed that way. There are men that will go. And I said, that was a meeting that they had in Indonesia. They write to me, say, Riak, we want you to come. And we will feature you as the guest speaker. And you will preach on the end time, what shall be according to the times that shall be. And I said, it would be a beautiful thing if men had had the wisdom of Yah, that these young men here would have been strong and vibrant. You send three there to a place like that. Come on, live simple. And you don't even have to go prepare with the message. One, get up and they can preach 30, 40 days in a row. This one preached today, and this one not trying to outdo that one. Just take from one of the verses that one preached from and expound upon that one. And the next one will preach, you will hear what he said. Take that in, he expound on that. And it goes back, the first one heard what the last one said. It goes back, that's not this damn twisted generation. Everyone wants to try to outdo one another. I think they possess something. I said, what a beautiful thing it could have been. Because you all would have been ambassadors from the labor of Yah's tongue here in Teshua. And these damn fools are doing nothing for Yah. I get invitations all the time. They're in South Africa, Kenya, Tanzania, Ethiopia, Indonesia, Philippines.
They write, come, India, Pakistan. I said, you simply learn the dialect of the people and learn how to say a few words, to say thank you, Yabrach, we're glad to be here with you, and you go. They're not doing a damn thing, and they're not going to do a damn thing. Yah says, you have destroyed your prophets like a destroying lion. Did he not say there in Gilneana Revelation that this one shall be granted great authority, and he and his mouth as the mouth of a lion? There's nothing more powerful. There are beasts that are more powerful, and their bite than the lion. But there is nothing more vicious than the jaws of a lion, the erim. The polar bear has a much more tenacious bite than the lion. When the alligator grips one in his clutches, you're not getting by. But there is nothing, no beast that is more vicious. And when the mouth of the lion speaks, as Yisra'iyah has spoken to the prophets, the messengers, it is one of rejection and to destroy. You tell me you love me today, and then you put a sword in my back tomorrow. You see, these are the kinds of men. And this is the attitude whereby the son of Esav, these are the sons of Esav. And you're not going to identify them by some kind of damn pigmentation of the color of your skin. That all white folks are Esav, and then the white ones say all blacks are Esav. You're not going to identify them through that DNA. They must have the DNA of the one, and when one blasphemes the name of Yah, there are those that will raise up in total defiance when you mention his name. Your kinsmen, your relatives, they deny that, they will get angry. They will get upset. And this one shall cause the summit or the rule of their mind, and the mark of their mesach, their mind, shall be a mind that blasphemes, that discount, that has contempt and condemns the name of Yah. And you relish in their damn fellowship and dining at their tables, offering up demonic offerings to the damn gods. I won't sit with them. I won't eat at their banquets. I don't give a damn if it's mammon-law or papillaw. I will not. You can. I will not. And that's a fact. It is rights, man. And we think it's just a little shallow thing. No. I may sit, but I won't eat. I don't give a damn if my belly is churning and hungry as they come. I won't eat among the dogs that reject Yah's truth. I won't sit down and eat with them. That's why I don't eat in their damn restaurants. I don't eat in their damn restaurants. Hallelujah. I don't want the damn pigs cooking for me. I don't eat in their damn restaurants. I don't eat in their damn restaurants, their damn pizza, their damn cookies, their hot dogs. I don't eat their burgers. And never will. You can, but I will not. Hallelujah. Don't make many friends this way, you get upset. Moving on, Yahkahan says here. Yahkahan 13:3. He said, and I saw one of his heads, the Rush, as it were wounded to death, Muth, Maveth, that to die prematurely. And his deadly wound was healed. And all the world wondered after this beast. We asked the question, I do, why was the head wounded? Was that not how David the Philistine, when he took the stone that the builders rejected, when he took the rock, when he took that ebon, and he cast it forth between his eyes, and he took the head of the sword and cut the beast's head off. There's only one thing that's going to take the head off of this beast, and that is the power of the Torah of Yah dwelling in us. He said one of his rush was wounded, and he said, and all the world was just so consumed, and they wondered because of that. You can't speak against faggots. You can't talk like that. This is amazing here. Why is it that there was a head womb, Yisra'iyah?
I want to give you an illustration of that in the book of Habakkuk. In the book of Habakkuk, chapter 3. I know many times we don't even know where these books are because you don't never go to them. Because you're going to read from the book of Matityahu, a few chapter or chapter, and that's it. I don't read, period. I never read the Torah. I don't read it to relax. I don't read it to unwind. I don't read it to be read. I don't do it that way. I study Allah Haq. That's the way I read it. It says in the book of Habakkuk, as the nobi of Yah beseech, as Yah is beseeching us today, he's cried out unto Yisra'iyah, his people, to understand, to have wisdom. Yah says, he says the nobi Habakkuk 3:13, he says, Yah, you went forth for the deliverance of your people. You sent forth your might, your hand, to deliver your people. We are in a time. And the time of great tribulations, of the czar of great oppression and depression, is upon Yisra'iyah. And Yah sent forth himself to bring his people out of the bondage. He said, even for the deliverance, your Yoshak, of your Mashiach. Yah sent forth the one to bring them out of the great bondage. And even him on the great tyranny of darkness, you cause him to rise up out of the depth of darkness. He said, you, Mahatz, you wounded, Yah did that? He said, you wounded, Mahatz, you subdued that one to destroy you. You wounded, listen now, you wounded the head out of the house of the wicked. Is this one coming against Yah as a wicked? And all of you don't understand the wounded, and I saw one of the heads. As though it was Mahatz. And it was healed. And the world wondered behind it. But Shabaka says, you brought the excellent of your lineage out. And yet you have wounded the head out of the house of the Rasha, the wicked. You have wounded the head. Your strength. And the delusion is though that it is healed. And it is not healed, Yisra'iyah. It is not. It has not the Rapha of Yah. It is not healed. When a man, when a woman, when an Ish and Ishua is healed, they have the complete confidence in the assurance of Yah. Iyob said, though he slay me, I will not deny him. We have no confidence in Yah like that. And there were seven trials of Iyob. It brings about the perfection. There were seven heads to exemplify the completion of authority and perfection. There are seven Ruachim of Yah, and that's what you want to call it, the cardinal number. Damn the cardinal number. But in the numerics of Yah, seven signify the tomim, the completion, the whole, the perfection of the matter, the entirety of it. That's what it does. So in order for this and these spirits to operate, there must be a complete authority of those spirits in the mind of a people or one, Esav, one that hates Yisra'iyah. One that has disdain for Yisra'iyah. Well, my mother, she's not Esav. She hates his name. She blasphemes his name. She detests the name of Yah. She rejects his name. And she pursue a damned Jesus, a Lord, and a vile Baal, and one of the most impugnant dogs on the earth, a damned God. And we don't want to identify them as the Zerah, the seed of Edom, that dwells in the mountain or the hair of Seir or the high place. That's what a hair is, a mountain. It is the high place. We don't want to say that.
We don't want to deal with that which is personal unto us. The prophet said that the head, or the head out of the house of the wicked, he wounded the head out of the house of the wicked. How, Yah? By discovering the foundation to the neck, by exposing, by destroying. You know, it takes that neck in order for this to be supported, doesn't it? And the neck is the strength of this. It's one thing that the elephant, that beast, that an elephant head, you notice an elephant has a very, it has no neck. It's all made into his body. You know why? Because an elephant's head weighs minimum a big bull, a ton, or better. That's a lot of head meat there, isn't it? That's what a bull elephant weighs. His head alone weighs one ton. One ton, just the head alone. Who could create something like that? That did not evolve out of some amoeba. That came out of the directives of Yah, out of his book of scientific perfection. Let it be. Hallelujah. The prophet speaks. Let me read that again. He said, you went forth for to deliver your people. That's what he did. Yah is causing the wound to this head. He's delivering us from out of this power or this mind of Esav. And we love the mind of Esav. Everything that blasphemes Yah, everything is wicked. Even for the deliverance of your Hamashiach, your Mashiach, you wounded, in order to deliver Yahshua, you wounded your people, your prophet. You wounded the head out of the house of the wicked by discovering the foundation of the neck. You did strike through with your own arrows the head of his leaders. Was it not one of the heads as though that it was wounded? Was it not? Did the world not marvel after this restoration of this constitution that the minds of all the people, that's why, for an example, I use this for an example. They're trying to thrust this damn homo dogism on every nation today. This damn nation trying to thrust that. Trying to thrust this blatant murdering and killing of the babies in the womb and wound in their heads. Do they not go in there with the late term abortions and strike the head of the baby? Are these wicked men that are doing that? Yah says, I will wound the head of the wicked. The wicked leaders. The heads are wounded today, Yisrael. There's no life in the head. And they're looking for healings. And Mr. Obama, does he not have a summit at the White House? Does he not call all the religious leaders of the world? He called those in America. He called the Muslims. He called those damnable fake lying Judaism or Judaistic type leaders. And the damn vile Christian ones. He called all of them. Call me Mr. Obama. Can you imagine the spirit in that place when all those people come in there? It is vile. It is unclean. It stinks like hell. Can you imagine the confusion of all that pukery and damnable vile odor? I walk in there and they all, even he will, the president, when I walk in there, they all would pay attention. Who is that man? That's right. Are you bold? I know I'm bold. I stand with confidence in Yah's Torah. I will walk in with my mammy-me clothing on and they all will ponder and wonder. That's a fact. No doubt about that. I don't need no Pierre Cardin suit, no alligator shoes. When I walk in the place, they will take notice. Hallelujah. You can be the buttocks all you want to. He has made me to be the head, the one that is an authority. I will not relegate my responsibility, all right? This will make sense as I conclude. Listen. You did, Yah, verse 14, Habakkuk 3:14. You did strike through with his own arrow, the head of the leaders. They came out as a whirlwind to scatter me. Their rejoicing was to devour the poor or the dell secretly. That's what the whole order is about, to destroy. Blessed are the poor in Ruach For we are the ones that are going to see. We're going to be manifest before the presence of Yah. And they are against the ones that are poor, the oni, the ones that are poor. Secretly, they have their lats, their order against them. That's what it says, Yisra'iyah. And this prophet saw it. He saw it in a different fragment of light than Yaqaham, but it all is consummated in Yahshua, the revelation of Yahshua. When Yahshua is revealed unto us, then we see all of this in the clarity and the purity of the picture that all of the writers tried to illustrate unto us. Yah says here in Habakkuk 3:15, you did walk through the sea with your horses. He calls even Mizraim to come through the sea through their horses, through the heap of the great waters. And then look at what this Nobi says in verse 16. He said, when I shemach, when I heard, he said, my belly trembled. Did not Yochanan tremble? Sure he did. He said, my belly trembled and my lips quiver at the voice of Yah. It quivered. He said, rottenness entered into my bones. And I tremble in myself that I may rest when in the day of trouble. We as Yisra'iyah, we must have rest in this day of trouble. Is not this time that Yochanan talking about the day of trouble? Is it not the day of Yah? It is not the wrath of Yah. He said that my ruach, my nefesh, my life, that I can rest, I can have a shabbaton in the yam of great oppression, great agony. Yah said, I have sent forth the sword to wound the head of the wicked. That's why he that reads, let him understand. We must get wisdom. You're not just going to get wisdom by reading what Yochanan said. You got to read what Habakkuk said, and Obadiah, and Amaziah, and the prophets of old. Yes, you must understand. He says, I tremble that I may have rest in the day of trouble when he comes up to the people, he will invade them with his troops. And the troop, we know that troop, the word troop is the God of nations. It implies the God of fortune. Troop, that's what it does. I'll teach on it one day. And that's what it does. And so it's not the nations being overrun with this God of troop. Oh, that's what Jesus is. He's a God of troop to get riches and to get blessings and to have much. They don't have the Berakiah of Yah. The Berakiah of Yah consists of his Isha, that we are blessed richly and we're happy with all that Yah has supplied. Our hearts rejoice with fatness. And that's why we can offer unto Yah the offering of the Zabach, the sacrifice, the Zabach, that is complete. It is pure. It is word of honor. And that's why this whole matter is about the offering. And that's why this one that shall rise up, he said, I saw this one. He said, let me look at this again in Habakkuk. Hallelujah. One word in verse 15. He said, you did walk through the sea, the Yah, with your horses. Did not Yochanan see one as he stood on the sands of the sea? And he saw one rise up out of the sea. Did he not see this entity, this power of hell, rise up out of the masses of the people there? Their assault against Yah. It's almost like when Pilate said, who would you release this day? Yahshua of Barabbas. And they railed, give us Barabbas, give us Barabbas, give us Barabbas. We rather have the beast. And so out of the vases of the people, of the masses of the people, take the sword, kill every messenger of Yah. We don't want to hear a damn thing. That's why those powerful ones shall lie in the street. And that's literal. And it is also a figurative and a spiritual manifestation. We'll get to that as we go on. That's why they shall kill them and destroy them. That's why Yah says to Yisra'iyah, he said, with the mouth of a lion, you have killed the prophets. You have destroyed them. You've caused him to be bewildered. You have exacted out of him everything that was a benefit to you. That's what this nation does. The true messenger, they don't want him to speak. A simple messenger, they don't want. They don't love him. Men say they love you and they don't give a damn about you. They say they stand with you and they're damn liars. That's why I let my words be few. When it comes to things like that, I don't tell these men I love them. I want my actions to speak louder than words. I want my commitment. I don't walk around all day telling my issue, I love you, I love you. No, I don't tell her that. I say to her, my actions, my deeds, my ruach, my response, my caring for you. If it doesn't speak, then you don't have a damn mind. It means nothing. Ma'ak Mikaya never tells me he loves me. But he's kind and gentle to me, always considering me. Is this sure? He's never told me that all these years he's been coming here. He may have once. And if he's done it once, I will be surprised. But I've had many to study. I love this man. Go to hell. What do you mean, man? Your words, take them to your barren mind that rejects Yah. You shut up from Yah. You shut up from Yah. That's why you shut up from me. Your mind is shut away from Yah, so you shut away from me. They want pantses today, little boys. Won't deal with the sins of the nation. Moving on, please, Yisrael. Back to Revelation 13:4. It says, because this beast's head was healed, it says, and they worship the Tani, the dragon, which gave power to the beast. And they worship the beast, saying, who is like the beast? Who is like this beast? Who is able to make war with him? How do you overcome? You overtake? You cannot. This is the expression. Well, there is nothing we can do. This Tanin, this powerful entity, this assault against Yah, Yisrael, he is going to save his house, his people. He's going to deliver them. As the old folks would say, thank Yah for the Nobi, because there's one that speaks here clearly. His name is Yeshaya, Isaiah. Hallelujah. Who is able to make war with him? Who is able to overcome him? This prophet speaks of this day or that day. Yeshaya, Isaiah 27:1. It says, in that day, not just a day, specifically, in that day, Isaiah 27:1, in that day, Yah with his sword, his great and his strong sword. He said, who is able to make war with this Tani? But Yah says, in that day. The prophet says in that day. The Nabi says in that day. Man says, who is able to overcome him? Who is like him? There's one that is greater than this beast. And the prophet says in that day, in this precise time that Yochanan writes about. He says, Yah with his great, his gadol, and his koach, strong mighty sword, his harapah, his word, his hamashiach, his surah, shall punish Leviathan or Leviathan. Who is able to make war with this Tani, this beast? You will not understand what Yochanan wrote about unless you can understand what this Leviathan is. You must. Who is able to make war with him? But Yah says, in my judgment, in my strength, in my might. Oh, this is correlated here. You understand? And I'll tell you at the conclusion of this part. It's going to take two parts to teach this. I'm going to teach the verse 10, then I'll finish the next on next week. Then we will understand the mark of the beast. And man calls man to take the mark in their right hand or in their mesach, in their yamin. All right? Hallelujah. Yeshua said, in that day, in the day of great trials, in the day of great affliction, in the day of Zah, in that day, Yah, with his sword and great and strong swords, shall punish Leviathan, the piercing serpent. Is not Hashatan the serpent, the Tani? Was he the most subtle serpent in the garden? It's going to be by the hands of Yah. He's going to pierce. Did they not pierce the body of Yahshua HaMashiach? Did they not pierce him in the side? You think that the enemy did not know the prophecy of what was written? Had they had known, they would have not impaled Yahshua. And Yah says, I'm going to pierce the serpent, the piercing serpent, even Leviathan, that crooked Nahash, that crooked beast. That crooked beast. Yah says, even him, that crooked beast. And Yah says, and he shall slay the dragon that is in the in the midst of the people. You understand, Yisrael, there is no power to overcome and to destroy this Nahash unless it is by the words of the Eri. You must have the mouth of a lion. When the lion roars, I have listened, have seen the video clips, that even when the lion roars, his voice can be heard 2 or 3 miles in the distance. You understand? That is a true kara, a crying, a true crying, a true crying out. 2 or 3 miles, his voice can be heard. And even the beasts of the field stand still to try to calculate the distance and the closeness of that voice. And when that one stands up out of the lion of the tribe of Yehudah, and when he commands the army of Yah, even this piercing serpent of hell, he shall be brought down to the gates of darkness, into hell. There's a reason why we're going through what we're going through. There's a reason why we're going to be afflicted. As he was afflicted, so shall we be. No, as he was. We have done things to our natural being to afflict ourselves. We have sown corruption, and we are reaping corruption. We must sow to the Ruach of Yah, that we may reap life everlasting, Yisrael. What is the life everlasting? It is the power of the testimony of Yahshua, that nothing destroys that. When mom and daddy turn against you, when the whole spectrum of relatives and kinsmen reject you, believe me, when they reject you, they don't give a damn about you. They're not going to bid you any kind of speed. They're not going to come for your fellowship. They don't give a damn, Yisrael, and that's the truth. And if they're bidding you some kind of speed somewhere, there's the connection there. I don't give a damn who you are. You can get upset with me, but that's all right. Hallelujah. A man's foe, his enemy, shall be of his own house in this hour. His enemies. They're crying for you, something is wrong. Hallelujah. Can I proceed a little farther? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yah says that he shall slay the dragon in the midst of the sea. He's going to bring down their stronghold, even among them all. It's coming down. America is coming down. The G7. There's 7 super powerful nations. Are they not? And they are the dictates of all the world. Are they not? They are the super G7. They meet once a year or twice, G7. Or they have other little gatherings, or the gatherings of the Americas. That's what Mr. Obama was down there in Colombia when these sisters will be protecting him, running after whores. These vile, faggoty, feminine men. They don't have the strength of Uriah, because Uriah said, I know Bathsheba is beautiful. That even the king that had a turret of any kind of woman he wanted. But that woman, she spoke volume. When he saw that, he said, I got to have it. He should have been about Yah's affair. And yet the man that was a warrior is about Yah's affair. And these damn bastards down there supposed to be protecting the leader. And then media wants to protect them. Well, consider their family. They did not consider the family that they were supposed to have been protecting. They didn't give a damn, Yisrael. Let's get real and speak honestly about the matter. I don't give a damn. I don't care what Mr. Obama does. It will not affect me. What is right is right. These damn dogs are supposed to be protecting him and boasting and putting the man in perils like that. I'm glad they were exposed. I'm glad. They should have been exposed. All of them. Well, I know their families, well, they're going to suffer. Their poor family is suffering every day because of the policies of the one you voted for. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Back to Giliana, Revelation. We're going to point it out. 13:5. Got five more verses to go. Revelation 13:5, Giliana, and there was given to him. Now you notice the word given, Nathan. It was bestowed, it was granted unto him a theph, a mouth, a language, speaking great things. And look at this. Naasa, or blasphemy, blasphemy, great things and blasphemy. And power was given unto him to continue 3.5 years, 42 months. He was given a mouth to blaspheme. Is there any, can we find in Torah a nation of people who have been given that mouth to blaspheme? Yeah, we must. You cannot look at these words and then write them off and say you understand because you have no understanding. You have read something. You have no light of the knowledge of that matter. You simply read. We must search the dockets of the prophets and see what the prophets say. Out of his mouth, he was given a mouth to speak. It did not say small things, but great things. And out of that loin flowed this blasphemy. When you blaspheme, you say, damn God, he is not associated with any God. No more than Yisrael is associated with a people or a nationality. It is Yisrael, an elect, a people. His mouth uttered great blasphemy. Can we find the seed of that origin of this one where he shall rise out of the nation of people? Well, let's examine the book a little here. In the book of Yeshaya, Isaiah. This Ruach dwells in a certain people to blaspheme Yah. Well, I'm not calling on that name. Listen to this in Yeshaya 35. I'm sorry, Yeskel. Ezekiel 35, verse 12. How to begin reading. Yah says to his nation, his people, he says to us, and you shall yada that I am Almighty Yahweh. He did not say you shall yada haya. He says you shall recognize that I am haya. I have come in. I have entered in. I am the one. You shall yada that I am Yahweh. And I have heard all your Yisrael, all your blasphemies, which you speak. I'm sorry. Again, he's talking to people now. Esau. He says, I've heard all your blasphemy, which you have spoken against the mountain of Yisrael. Shall this one rise? He shall have seven heads. Shall he have not seven heads? And they shall be the rush or the mountain or the high places. He says to Esau here, I've heard all of your blasphemy, which you have spoken against the mountain of Yisrael, saying, they are laid desolate. They are given us to consume. So Yisrael is given unto Esau to be consumed. This is the heart of Esau. This is the mindset. You will know the very spirit of Esau when you find those that will think that they can subdue and destroy the mountain of Yah. What does the mountain of Yah represent? It represents the place whereby the power of the testimony of Yahshua shine with a great brightness and a great brilliancy into the bosom of Yisrael scattered throughout the earth. And that we shall know one another because we reside in the high places or of the high place of Yah, which is his Torah. So Esau said, we can bring them down, we can destroy them. Yah said, this with your mouth, You have boasted against me. This is what Esau has done. You have boasted against me and have multiplied your words against me. And Yah said, I've heard them, that this is the Nobi, Yeskel, prophesying against Edom, or the Edomites. He said, I've heard them. This says, Yah, this is what Yah utters. When the whole earth rejoices, did not Yahkahan say they shall wander after him whose head was healed? And the word wonder, they shall be excited. He's talking to the people of Edom here. This is a prophecy. When all the earth rejoice, Yah says, I will make you shemama. I will make you desolate. I will devastate you and bring you down to the waste as dung of the earth. As you did rejoice, because the inheritance of Beit Yisrael, because it was desolate. Yah said, you rejoice. When I put the stick on Yisrael, you rejoice when I brought them low, and to show them, to prove them, to show them they had no strength of their own, you rejoice in that. And the way you rejoice in that, that's why, you know, there was old proverb among the people of my heritage. You don't kick a man when he's down. You don't do that. You don't mock a man. You don't do that, Yisrael. I don't care if he's your enemy. Leave it alone. Don't mess with it. Don't rejoice in it. I rejoice in no man's affliction, no man's suffering. Just leave it alone. I may not mess with it, but just leave me alone. You don't kick a man when he's down. I don't care who the man is. I don't care what he's done against you. Don't kick him. You don't kick him. Leave him alone. He will probably spit on you if you tried to help him. Listen to what Yah says in Yeskel, Ezekiel 35:15. And you did rejoice because of the inheritance of Beit Yisrael, because of the inheritance, because it was desolate. There was no light to their heritage. They were walking as a people of gloom, and you rejoice in that, Edom. You Edomite, you rejoice in that. When they were oppressed, you rejoice in that. When they were downtrodden, you rejoice in that. When they had no boots to put on, you say they must pick themselves up by the boot of their own feet. You rejoice in that. This is y'all talking. This is not me. You understand? So I will do the same thing to you. You shall be desolate, O mountain Seir, and all, not some, but all Edom, even all of it, and they shall know that I am Yah. It is Yah that is orchestrating this matter. And the heritage of Yisrael is desolate. And yet in the midst of all of that, because we have the power of the testimony of Yahshua, and we love not our lives unto the death, and we keep the mitzvah of Yah, he's going to work on the behalf of Yisrael. And the man is being nurtured today out of the bosom of Edom to mock Yisrael and say, where's your mighty one? Damn your God, Edom. Yeah. Yah says, I got it. You mock them, for I shall mock you. And your land shall be desolate. It shall not bear fruit, but yet we shall bear fruit in the midst of a desolate place. We shall bear the peri, the fruit of life. We shall bear the testimony of Yahshua HaMashiach. You understand, Yisrael? We shall bear the abundance. And when the King of Beauty comes, we're going to have not just fruit. We're going to have the abundance of the peri. And you're talking about a fruit offering that day. Hallelujah. You're talking about a separation between Ka'an and Hebel. It shall be made known. You understand, Yisrael? We're going to offer the peri, the fruit, not only of our lips, but the fruit of his abundance that shall flow from Yisrael. That's what the matter is all about. That's why the enemy is trying to establish a fruit-bearing tree in the midst of the nation. And it is all twisted and warped. It doesn't bring forth the excellence of the fruit of Yisrael. He's going to cause all. And this is the catalyst to cause. Because Yah, when he caused his hand to fall on Edom, the Edomites are scattered, just like Israel, in every nation, all over. When he caused his hands to fall, woe unto a people. Woe unto a nation, for they have mocked Yisra'el. They have mocked Yisra'el. Just like Esau said, as sure as Yitzchak, when he dies, I'm going to take the boy's head off. And that has not changed. That spirit is still persistent. And so in order to get to the one that granted the privilege, I'm going to kill every last one of the seeds. So we're going to have them aborting babies and killing babies and destroying babies, but they still did not get to the seed. When Pharaoh said, kill every baby, they still didn't get to the promise, the chosen, Moshe. They did not, Yisra'el. When Herod said, kill everything, kill them all. I don't give a damn whose baby, kill them all. They could not find the elect one. And when Esau says, kill them all, damn it, kill every damn one of them. Don't even let them breathe breath. If you don't kill them in the mother's womb, then you kill them then, because they're going to grow up to resist me and to resist my authority. Kill them all. Kill them in the mother's womb. And that's what these dirty bastards are doing today, the mind of Esau, to blaspheme and to destroy and say that life doesn't begin at conception. They're damn lawyers. When the seed is fertilized, it's a baby. It has not developed, but it's a baby. You tell me life is not in that seed. We planted seeds yesterday. We planted them in the earth. You tell me that there's no life in the seed out there that we planted? When death begins to break that seed down, it began to emulsify. It began to produce life. And these dirty bastards sending forth one of the most powerful spirits, death, killing, destroying. And they're so vicious that they do it in the nations. They kill you like a dog, especially this nation. You can call me what you want to. You can call me a disgruntled man. I'm not disgruntled at all. I'm happy. I got someone to lay my head tonight. I got food to eat. I can work hard. I can see the beauty of the garden. Man, I love to work the garden. I intended to be there until noon. I was out there all day yesterday with the app and could have continued. You understand? Because I'm the type, man, when I set my mind to do something, I want to get it done. I'm not slothful about any affairs. When I say this, I know how we can do it. We're going to do it. You understand? I don't pretend. Don't tell me you want to work with me. Come on, man. You better be real. Because when you say that. I turned out a man the other day, said he wanted to come and work here. I said, I don't want you. No, you can't come here and do that. I meant what I said. I don't want you coming here to work. I'll do the job that I would have had you to do. No, I don't want you to do that. And I mean that. I mean that. We're not here to be playing. I'm here because I'm sincere. Hallelujah. Verse 6 in Gilgana, Revelation. Hallelujah. 13:6. He said, and this vile thing opened his mouth. I just read that, didn't I? No, this is it. This is important here. Revelation 13:6. And he opened his mouth. Everything he does is in blasphemy. Everything. Everything to contemn, to spawn, to profane, to utter assaults against. And he opened his mouth with blasphemy against Yah. Look now, look at what happened. Not only did he blaspheme against Yah, but he blasphemed his name, his Hashem, Hashem Cha. He spoke contempt against his name. And not only his name, but his Beit, his tabernacle, and them that dwell in Shemayim. He spoke against the threshold of Yah, his house. The prophet Yeskel, he gives us wisdom of this matter, what Yahkahan saw here in Ezekiel 43. As Yah gives this man a vision of the events that shall be in this hour, and this is the same event that he saw, but he expressed it somewhat a little different, but the same nuances. Ezekiel 43:8. Look at what Yah did with this man as he set him in his house, as Yah showed him the things that were among his people and the reason why. Ezekiel 43:8, he says, in their setting of the Saf, or the threshold of my threshold, of his tabernacle, the Saf, the entrance into his house, he said, as the setting of the threshold of the Saf, he says, also this Saf, by my threshold, he said, and their posts by my posts, and the wall between me and them, he said, they have even tormented, they have even defiled. What have they defiled? He said, my Kadosh name. Does he not say that? Does not this one open his mouth with blasphemy against the name of Yah? Does he not do that? Does not this one defile the threshold of Yah's tabernacle, his bed? And that spirit dwells in us, we do that. When Yah tells us to enter into his courts with Todah and into his presence with Todah, we defy his Saf. We come and say, I don't give a damn. I don't feel like it. I said again, I will, man. Talk to me. Tell me to come on. We come into Yah's presence. We defy his Saf. I'm going to make it plain now. When he commands us to enter into his presence with Todah, with such damn pretenders of falsehood, and we believe we are right, and we defy what he says. Well, you don't know how I feel. Well, I tell you, what if you think him, he is able to complete you. You just don't know how I feel. There are those that are in agonizing assaults from the enemy. Whatever our situation is, we Todah Yah, we give Yah Todah, because as he's able to bring us out, no one can bring us out but him. Yah says, they have told me, yes, scale Ezekiel 43:8, they have defied my Kodesh name. Out of this beast, out of the utterance of Edom or the Edomites, out of the spirit of where the children of hell are nurtured, and we're given over unto the same appetite as the Edomites. Out of his mouth shall be blasphemy, and they have defiled my Kodesh name. By the abominations there to Abar that they have committed. Wherefore I have consumed them in my wrath, my anger, the distilling of my great hostility toward them. Yah says to us as the prophet speaks, and we must utter, now let them put away their Zinuth, their Horem. Put away your damn gods. Put away your Lord, your Baal, your Christ, your Jesus. Put away your damn gods. He said, let them put away their Zenuth. And not only that, and the carcasses of their kings. We in this nation here, we love our dead kings. We love our George Washingtons. Who's on a $100 bill? Hamilton, who's on that bill? I don't know. Who's on a $100 bill? Anyone know? We used to say that in the day, give me them George Washingtons, huh? See, they love their deceased kings. They love their dead kings. We love them dead dollar bills. That's what he says here. He says, and not only that, he says that let them put away their whoredom and the carcasses of their dead kings, their melechim. Let them put away the carcasses. You love that more than you love Yah. You will get crazy about a dead king, and you love what that dead piece of paper does. That's just the truth. You will lie, you will steal, you will do something dirty for a dead king. Or they got monuments to Abraham, Lincoln, George Washington. Y'all say, put these damn pagan things out of the midst of you, Yisrael. Don't you pay homage to that. We got Martin Luther King with a big bust of him. Y'all said, I would not even take myself to walk in front of any of their damn dead kings. I don't give a damn if it's Martin Luther King or any of them. I will not go to their places of memorial. I will not go to their walls of death, whereby even the soldiers, their ignorance, they were caught up in the folly and the subduction of a nation, to kill and to murder, to maim, to destroy nations of people, and they put their names on a stone wall, and I go kiss that. Not me. I will bow before the rock. It is one thing that this enemy has always tried. If you be the son of Yah, command the stone. So they got their rocks everywhere, don't they? They got their monuments everywhere. I'm going to bring it all home one day. I may die trying, so you ought just take it over from there. Just read it and preach it. It will come out. So that was not something coincidental that he said, a stone. We don't understand because we don't know how to read the book. You know how to read the sales paper. And the Walmart and the Kmart and the Dollar Mart. You can remember the prices on that and when the sale goes off. But we cannot zakha what Yah speaks unto us. What a shame. Hallelujah. What a shame. What a shame. He commands us, he says in verse 9, Yeskia 43:9. Now let us put away the zenuth and the carcasses of their kings. He says, put away the carcasses of their kings far from me. I will dwell in the midst of them forever, Olam Viad. He says this unto the messenger, you son of Adom. He says, show this bayat, this house, what you see, to my people. The vision of Yahkahan must be shown to you, Yisrael. He says, show this house, this rebellious house, show this bayat to Beit Yisrael, that they may be ashamed of their ovin, and let them measure the tunuk, or the tasnith, the pattern thereof. Let us weigh the pattern. Let us see what they laid out for us, and see what came to pass because they laid that out. Let us lay out the pattern of what was done in that house, that we do not perform the same thing in Yah's house. We have blasphemed his name. We have come across himself into his tabernacle, his bayat, and we do not render unto him that which is just and due. That is what the mind of Esau does, and that's what it's all about. That's why this one shall rise up. He shall speak great things, and he will cause you to deny the name of Yah. Everything the summits of the world speak, the most powerful institution, mercantile, isn't that one? Finance, money, mercantile. That's it is, Yisrael. It is. And their pharmaceutical, pharmaka, their god of the Greeks, all of that. These are powerful entities in every part of the world, Yisrael. Yah says, put away your dead kings. Put away those presidents' day, your reverence of those things which do not reverence. Isn't that amazing? And they will not honor the Mo'adim of Yah. And there are those that question that whether we should keep it, I don't know. Well, you know, he hates your feast days. He does hate your feast days. But he loves his feast days. And that's a fact, Yisrael. Let us, Yisrael, we began as the prophet says, as we see the picture that is prevailing, let us begin to be ashamed of our transgressing, our iniquity, our defyings of the Torah. When one commits ovon, it's because one is defying the Torah of Yah. And we should be ashamed of that. And then when we understand that, then let us measure the pattern that which has already been laid out. Let us measure that. Let us make sure all, as the old folks would say, all of our I's dotted and our T's are crossed. We must begin that. We must lay out and weigh the pattern of Yahkahanan against the pattern of the writers of the old covenant, Yisrael. We must weigh it out. You must get an understanding of the matter. We're dealing with an assault against the very pinnacle of Yah, the mind. He dwells in the mind. He dwells in the love of Yisrael. This is an organ that beats. Simple, 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 simple. This is the organ, the centrality of man, where life is emanated, where the source of life. How do I know that? Because I know that Yah is the head of Yahshua. And Yahshua is the head of Ish, and the man is the head of the woman. I know that. Her life consists, is rejuvenated, is made strong by her summit. It's just the truth. And it's one thing that the world has done to dismantle that. Young women leave home when they're 17, 18. And under the covenant of Yisra'el, the daughter stayed there until she was married to see the strength of the Rush, the head. Nation tell you get 17, you're on 18, I'm out of here. And so the women are left to raise sons of their own, and they're making them effeminate. They're making them effeminate little boys. They're making the boys effeminate boys. There's nothing more effeminate than a man that has been raised by his mother, if she has truly raised him. I don't care if they're ball players or whatever. That's a fact. You find the strength of a true man, you will have some man that has played a prominent role in his life. You find the beauty of a woman, there's some man that somewhere in her life has played a beautiful role. And she has admired him and saw his beauty, his strength, his character, his great regard, his great love. She has seen that. And because she has seen that, it caused her heart to be open to the laws of Almighty Yah, the Creator. It must be Yisra'el. Hallelujah. No doubt about that. No doubt about that. No doubt about that. And that's a fact. Hallelujah. Moving on expeditiously. This is something vital here in verse 7. I want you to hear this now. Hallelujah. I'm going to try to finish this today. If not, we'll just proceed on. Revelation, Gilgana 3:7. Now this is what was given to this kingdom power. You must understand here, Revelation chapter 13, verse 7. The fourth word says given, nothan. It was given, and it was given. It was granted unto him. It was bestowed now. It was permitted by one of great authority to grant that. And it was given to him to make war, milchaya, with the Israelites, Jerusalem. Revelation 13:7. And it says, and to Yahuwah to overcome. You'll hear that? He was given power to prevail, power to endure even against their endurance. He was given power to make sure that he was able. So that was granted by one that having the greater authority. Hallelujah. He says, and to overcome them, and power was given him over all kindreds and tongues and goim. Now, if that is the summation of what I've preached, then we as a people, we have no chance against this freak nature of hell. But we must search the document. And we must search that word Yahuwah, overcome, to prevail, to persist, to have the power, the authority. There's one prophet here that enlightens us, Jeremiah. Jeremiah 23 in verse 9, quickly I want to read. And this chapter speaks against those that he calls his Re'ach. They are the one that are destroying his sheep and scatter the house of Yisra'el and those that are of his pasture. Jeremiah 23:9, he says, my love within me, it is Shabbat, it has been broken. Because, this is Yah, this is the prophet speaking to us in the stead of Yah. Because of the Navi'im, all my bones shake. He said, I am like a drunken man and like a valiant warrior whose wine, whose yayin, has overflowed. come, whose own substance. And this one will give us the wine to drink to overcome us, Yisra'iyah. But we know that we are going to drink the renewed wine in the kingdom of Almighty Yah and Yahshua. So when we sit down to drink, we're drinking from the Yahyan, the wine, the fresh pressed wine of Yah, this living word that when we hear it, it calls us to come alive daily and continuously. He said, as one that has been overcome with wine, he said, because of Yah and because of his Chodesh word. Why is this happening? Why is this one is going to be able to overcome? He tells us in verse 10, for the land is full of na'ath. It is full of spiritual adultery, religious pontification, every kind of wicked activity. For the land is full of adulterers. For because of swearing, or they vow this Allah, this curse of destruction, because of swearing. He said the land is abal, it just mourns, it cries continuously. The pleasant place of the wilderness are dried up. He said because their course is evil and their force is not right. We know that our force is right. This force that is being established in the earth, it is not right. That's why we find every kind of adulterous or na'af spirit in the land. Every kind of religious practice, every kind of God worship, every kind of participation, we find that. He says, for both Nobi and Kohan, priest, he said, they are Hanef, they are deluded, they're defiled, they're polluted, they are corrupt. Yes, Yah says, in my bayat, I have found their wickedness, says Almighty Yah. And if Yah find in this house, in this bed, the wine of Na'af and the wine of wickedness, you're going to be overcome, Yisra'iyah. You're going to be subdued. You're going to be Yahol. He shall prevail against you. That's why our thoughts that are so corrupt, he says in that, I have found their wickedness in my house. Is not our bodies the tabernacle of Yah? Do our minds constantly utter and spew the very freshness of the Torah with thinking on Yah? We sing psalms and meditating on the Torah of Yah. Do we? Don't answer me. I know there are those out there in their self-righteous ways. They will say, oh, I do all the time. They're liars. Our minds, it is a constant purveyor of every kind of adulterous, every kind of spiritual wickedness in the high place of our mind is being spewed to profane this body of Yah. That the testimony of Yahshua HaMashiach, it is becoming contaminated, that we're afraid to even mention his name. We're ashamed of him in front of the wicked. We deny him before man. He's going to deny us before the Father. You'll be ashamed of him before a wicked and a corrupt generation. He will be ashamed of you. I'm not ashamed of him. I don't care what anyone says about me. I don't care how their actions or their attitude toward me. It makes me no difference. I'm going to stand. And I'm not giving up. Hallelujah. I'm not turning around. Not at all, Yisra'iyah. I'm not that easily persuaded. Not in corruption. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Because the Nobi and the Kohan, they are profane. They are Hanef. They become so corrupt, polluted, and defiled. And yes, Yah said, in my house, I have not found such wickedness. The prophet said, when I saw what was to be, he said, it was like almost the wine that overcame me. And the wine and the fierceness of the wine of the wrath of Yah is going to overcome many, Yisra'iyah. It said, and he caused all, rich, poor, small, great, to take the mark of the beast and man in the Yamin, in the Misach, that the direction is laid out, the order. And it's an order of blaspheming the mighty name of Almighty Yah and Yahshua HaMashiach. Yochanan gives us an account of who shall be overtaken in verse 8 of Revelation 13, 8. And all that dwells on the earth shall worship him whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the earth. Well, what book we think that is? Is Yahshua the Torah of Yah? He is a living Torah. If there's one that gives us a great insight of this, is Baruch. We'll read this quickly in the book of Baruch. First Baruch. Baruch 4:1. He says, this is the book of mitzvah, commandments of Almighty Yahweh. And the Torah that endures forever, despite opposition, it endures forever. For they that keep it shall come to high life. They shall come to life. But such as leave it shall die. He speaks to us. He says unto us, turn you, O Yaakov, and you must take hold of it. Walk in the presence of the light thereof, that you may be illuminated, that the light of Yeshua may shine from you. What is this book? Whose name is not in the book? Our names were in the Torah of Yah from the beginning, as Moshe writes. This book is the commandment of Yah, and the Torah that endures forever. And they that keep it shall come to life. We shall come to Yeshua, HaMashiach. We shall come to the life of Yeshua, our HaMashiach. And those that do not keep it, their names shall be not in this book. Hanak says here in Hanak 108, verse 1, as he began to write another book of Hanak, which he wrote for his sons, Methuselah, and for those who shall come after him. Are we after Methuselah? Sure we are. Observing the Torah in the last days. Are we in the Acharis? The Achrum. Should we not observe the Torah in the last days? He says, you who have observed the Torah shall wait patiently, shall endure patiently in all the days until the time of those who work evil is complete. Is not this what Yochanan saw, this testimony? What Yah is allowing is this testimony of the bosom of Edom to express itself against Yisrael. And it does it by expressing its ought against the Most High. That battle has not ceased. It is still a battle. It is still alive, Yisrael. And it is in the bosom of the Edomites. Hallelujah. He said, unto those who work evil is finished complete. And the power of the wicked ones is ended. And the wicked ones, the power shall be ended. As for you, Yisrael, wait patiently until sin pass away. And the names of the sinner shall be blotted from the book of life. And the books of Yahweh, the Kodesh one. He's going to blot their names. We must understand that in the annals of Hashemayim, everyone that is born, the name is recorded. But that doesn't mean that their names shall be in the book of life. He said he's going to blot, he's going to take out the names from the book of life. And the books of Yahweh, the Kodesh one, the Kadosh one, Kodesh. He said their seed, their zirah, shall be destroyed forevermore. And their spirit shall perish and die. They shall cry and lament in the place that is an invisible wilderness and burn in the fire. From their exit ground there as upon the earth. Let no one tell you that there is no hell. Let these liars of the Jehovah lies and tell you there is no hell. Their worms shall not die out, period. It is for real. And our names that are in the bosom of Yah, and the only way is through the living Torah, Yahshua, is the word of Yah. And he is the one that, when that name, he is the one that That's your name. Even through death, that name could not be expunged from his bosom. He is the one that battled for that name, for those whose names are written. That's what it was all about. It was about a battle with life and death against darkness and light. And that's what this end time scenario shall be. One shall rise up out of the darkness of the mind of Adam, the Edomites, to extinguish the light of the testimony of Yisrael. That's what it's all about. One shall establish the pinnacle of the high, the rush of the seven powerful entities and spirits to battle against the Rochim of Yah, Yisrael. And shall establish the kingdom powers in the earth, and kings that are ruthless and vicious to eradicate the 10 tribes of Yisrael. That's just the truth, Yisrael. He has made this thing simple and plain. We need messengers to be able to labor and to open up this simple truth to us. We need that. Hallelujah. That's the truth. We need that, Yisrael. Listen to this account in the book of Jubilee. I'm going to close in a moment. Hallelujah. It says in the book of Jubilee, chapter 30, verse 21. In this account I have written for you, and I've commanded you to say to the children of Yisrael that they should not commit sin nor transgress the ordinance of Yah, nor break the covenant which has been ordained for them, but they should fulfill it and record it as friend. Verse 22, but if they transgress and work uncleanness in every way, they will be recorded on the heavenly tablet as adversaries. See, there is the book of those that are adversely opposed to Yah, and this is what is expressed to us. Those that walk and work and operate in continuously wickedness, it is recorded on the heavenly tablets as adversaries. And they will be destroyed out of the book of life. Yisrael, we cannot continue aggressively and walk in sin and defiance of Yah. We can't do that. And so out of this dominant horse, it tells us you're going to sin. Not so. The one that was caught in the act of adultery, Yahshua said, go and sin no more. Your sins are cleansed. We don't have to practice sin. And that's what this beast and the spirit has risen up today to tell us you're going to sin. And you must sin lies. You don't transgress the Torah. You don't blatantly defy what the Torah says. For we know that sin is a transgression of the Torah. You can't do that. Your name shall be destroyed in the book of life. And they will be recorded in the book of those who will be destroyed, and with those who will be rooted out of the earth. There's a book of life, and there's a book of life. And there are those that shall be uprooted and destroyed out of the earth, Yisrael. And Yah has set in the motion the catalyst to make sure that the seal and the melach, those that watch over the heritage of Yah, that those whose names are written in the tablet, that there is a witness to that. And so when this vile nature and this one rises up, and the spirit that permeates and emanates in the world, when it rises up, it shall draw the children of perdition unto them. That's why we have to be careful what we hear, careful what we lay our hands on. We don't lay our hands suddenly on no man. We don't just embrace any man or any woman. We just don't do that. We don't lay our hands on things that we ought not to lay our hands. We don't eat from the table that whereby it's been offered unto demons and unclean spirits. We don't do that. We cannot do that, Yisrael. Yeah. Two verses in, I want to finish up. Verse 9 and 10. Verse 9. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Gileana chapter 13, verse 9. I'm going to stop here, but I want to open your ears to something. And we will get to the catalyst on next. We will get to the overall. We want to fill in all the empty spaces, all right? Now, this is what Yah utters unto us. This is what the Nabi speaks to us in Revelation 39. If any man have an ear, let him hear. Is there a precise message we need to hear? The pattern is there when you have brought Yisra'el out of Misraim, out of the bondage, out of the shabuth of darkness. And that's what this is all about, to bring us out of this great captivity, Yisra'el. And there was a song that they began to sing in the book of Devarim. I want to read that. Devarim chapter 32, verse 1. He said, he that hath ear, let him hear. Isn't that what the prophet said? Yes. There's multiple scriptures that are katuv that will relate to this, that we get clear understanding. I want to inject one or two just to open our ears. He said, he that hath ear, let him hear. Now this is what Yah says to us in Devarim chapter 32, verse 1. What we must hear. Hear what? What are we hearing? Yah says this in Devarim, Deuteronomy 32:1. He says unto us, give azain, or give ear, give ear, give your ear, the ability to be obedient unto what you hear. The word azain, azain, not ozin, but azain, it is one hearing with the obedience to comply what you have heard and utilize it as Yah commands. So he commands us, he that hath ear, what Yahkahan said, if any man have ear, let him hear. So this is what we need to hear. Give ear, O you heavens. When Yah speaks, he tells the heavens, the Shemayim, to give ear. And I will speak and hear, O earth, the words of my mouth. Yah says that my doctrine of my lecha, that is what I teach you that you may learn, that will give you insight, shall drop as rain, and my speech shall drop down as dew. And the small rain upon the tender herb, and as the showers upon the grass. Now, y'all telling us to give ear because he wants us to understand his disposition to show us his disposition. Isn't that what Yahkahan showed us, the disposition of the spirit that shall be pervasive and prevail against the nations and overcome the people? Unless we have the power of this testimony, the light that we be illuminated. He says in verse 3, Yah says, because I will publish, and he used the word chara to proclaim, to cry out with a loud voice. He said, I will proclaim the name of Yahweh. Does it say that? Yes. This one that comes, will he not come blaspheming the mighty name of Yah? Yes. Is it not? That's the nature of this one that shall he shall blaspheme his name. His sons and daughters are organized in these conclaves to assault the name of Yah in their religious conclaves. He said, give ear. He said, for I will proclaim, I will kara, I will cry out loud, I will say it loud. He said, the name of Yahweh. He said, and you must ascribe your greatness to Yah, our Abba. This is the true characteristic of the nation of Yisra'el, that we proclaim the name of Yah and prescribe greatness to his name. And those that refuse to, or those that blaspheme his name, we know that they are of the nature of Esau, the Edomites. Verse 4, I want you to hear this now. Yahweh is the rock. This is important to remember this, because what I shall teach in the weeks to come in the Shabbat, this is going to be utilized here, even as the assault of Hashatan against Yahshua. If you be the son of Yah, command this stone that it be made bread. It is vitally important to understand that in the kingdom power that is rising up by the command of Yah, this kingdom of darkness, to filter out his people. And they're going to truly be filtered out. You understand, Yisra'el? Yah is the rock. His work is to me perfect. And all of his ways are mishpatim, judgment. A mighty one of truth and without avail, he's without injustice. He is tzaddik, just, upright is he. Yah says they have shochat, they have corrupted themselves, we as a nation. Their spot is not the spot of his children. Our characteristic and characteristics are not the spot of the characteristics of Yah, Yahshua. He says, we are a perverse and crooked generation. Are these the things you return to Yah? Yah say, if this is what you offer me for what I've done to you, if this is what you grant back unto me, O foolish people, Nabal, and unwise, is not Yah your Abba that has bought you? Has he not made you and established you? Is this what we give to Yah for what all he's done for us? Has he not bought us? Do we give credence and alliance unto the beasts of darkness? That we receive this oath, we declare this cursed vow in our mouths, and our hands, our right hand is turned against Yah. Is he not the one that has made us? Is he not the one that has established us, Yisrael? He has established us with the powerful testimony. The testimony of Yahshua HaMashiach. All opposition of hell cannot destroy the magnitude and the strength of that testimony. No one can. It is Yah that has made us, and we not ourselves, Yisrael. We must stand in the power of that testimony. We must, because there's a force of hell that assaults the mind. It assaults the Labah to take root, to establish a kingdom work of evil in your mind, that we become evil. We despise Yah's truth. We despise the hearing of his name. We despise the testimony of Yahshua. Cannot be. Cannot be. We as a nation, we must take a personal assault on the iniquity, the ovon, and the transgressing, the defiance, the pershak of the Torah of Almighty Yah. For this one that Yah has raised up, he has, for this purpose, for this cause, for my resolution, for my pleasure, I have raised up Pharaoh, one that has caused your agonies to be hard and oppressed. I've raised him up for one purpose, that I may get esteem and honor and exaltation upon my name. He has raised up the catalyst of hell, that he is going to get honor. And out of the true loins of true Yisrael, there shall be a praise that goes into the heavens like no other praise. None whatever in the midst of all the chaotic mayhem, there shall be a light of his elect. He will never distinguish the light in the earth, because if he does that, then once darkness prevail, no light will ever rise up. He has left us here to be the light of the earth, the salt of the earth. We will not lose our flavor, Yisrael, because we shall rejoice in the Torah. And when this one rises up to cause men to receive this mark and to cause their minds to be imprinted, we shall reject it by the power of that testimony of Yahshua HaMashiach. For in him we can do all things. For that is the strength of the Torah of Yah. And we shall overcome. Not like Mr. King said, we shall overcome. We're not going to beg for no rights. We're not going to beg for no civil rights. We shall overcome. May the riches of God rest upon your own. And by the way, we don't have to vote for no civil rights. May the riches of Yah rest upon you, all Yisrael. May strengthen you. May it cause the light of Yahshua to shine upon you. We do greet you all. Yah barak you all. Let us stand to our feet, Yisrael, here. We turn toward Yerushalayim. Yah says that as long as we're in this Shabbuth, that we turn toward Yerushalayim, he shall hear our kara, the pala we make. Oh, Almighty Yah, in Yahshua's name we bow. In your presence, you're great, and there is none like you. Give us wisdom in this simple truth today. Teach us and guide us that we may uphold your standard and live according to your will. We told you for call Yisrael, all of our hearts. Bless them all, strengthen all of your people here in Yahshua's mighty name. We do told you for every blessing, every rich thing you grant unto us, what you have given unto us, your excellent favor. We barak you for this day. Guide us all. Touch those that are in need. Touch each and every one of your Kedoshim scattered throughout the nation of the earth. We ask it all in Yeshua's name, for you're great, and there is none like you. And with our voices and our hearts, we cry, Hallelujah, 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 Yabarak Yisrael.